But it wasn't even Peanut Moore. It was, you know, it was a division of EA, but Peanut Moore stepped in to kind of, you know, apologize for one of their studios, you know. I think it was unnecessary. It was nice, but people need to stop being, you know, so butthurt about jokes. I mean, it's April Fool's. No holds barred. But anyway, go ahead.
No, you go ahead. We're down here still. We're already
on. So you talked about, yeah, but what, did I delete this here?
And of course.
Oh, yeah. Okay, I remember now.
Rockstar has announced that GTA 5 online play will feature heists this spring. You could actually do some heists on GTA 5 with all your friends. Yeah. So if you guys have ever thought about robbing a bank, please try it virtually first. See how it goes. If you get shot to hell, don't do it in real life. Just saying. You know, a little food for thought for you guys.
Yeah, definitely.
So that was really stupid. Far Cry 2's Linton Clint Hawking and Portal's Kim Swift joined Team Amazon Fire TV. You want to elaborate about this, little Yogi?
So yeah, Amazon Game Studios is putting out the Amazon Fire TV to kind of compete with Apple TV. Mm. Now, they say it's not going to be a gaming device, but they're going to have games available on it. Okay, whatever. But, you know, so we've been talking about the past few weeks, Apple's moving to the market, Amazon, and there's some other people that are stepping in, but, you know, it's interesting. But, I don't understand why they're saying it's not a gaming device, but they're getting people from gaming companies to join their team. It's like, okay, something's funny there, but whatever. That's all I got on that. I'm not even going to say anything else.
Yeah. But we might as well just keep going because I got nothing either. By the way, Game of Thrones returns this Sunday, guys. So if you like that show, get ready. Make sure your DVR is set. I'm sorry, and I'm catching up now as we speak, but I've started watching it, and I can't believe I didn't watch it from the beginning. I'm stupid. I know. I'm sorry.
See,
who's stoked about this? I mean, are you stoked about this, Yogi? Guys in chat, are you guys watch that and ready for this start back up?
Oh, I definitely am. And I can tell you that I'm like you. I waited. I held off on it. When the books came out and someone recommended me them, mm-hmm. I was like, this sounds like something that would be turned into a show. Sure enough, it did. And I said, well, I'm gonna hold off because I knew with all the hype there was, I would see a lot of spoilers as the show was going along. And that I also feel like when things are overhyped, I enjoy them less because then my expectations are set way too high. So I just only recently got into it like a year or so ago and did like marathon sessions, and I'm all caught up. Actually, it's been less than that.
I'm not even caught up yet. I'm trying to hurry up and catch up.
It's great. But now I'm dreading being caught up and having people spoil that season as they go along. But yeah, I'm stoked about it, definitely. To be good.
Well,
boobies.
Boobies. That's the focal point of every man, of every day. He wakes up and goes, boobies. Oh, there's some. Okay, more boobies. Where can I see some more boobies? That's just how we think. Microsoft's Xbox division. It was reported that by B-Team Podcast. They reported that Phil Spencer is now taking over the head of that division. Hopefully he can do something to keep... I don't want to say this the wrong way. No, you know what? I'm going to say it anyway. Hopefully he can actually make it better. Because in my eyes right now, and yes, all you guys know that Obi is Xbox, 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 Xbox. Screw it. Obi is now switching sides. I'm going to say it now. Yeah, Yogi, I don't care. PS4 all the way. Now, there's three reasons why I do this. If that's your prerogative, brother, I don't necessarily get into that. But two reasons why I'm doing this, okay? Xbox is, for one, just it's straight up pissing me off. I've been trying to get some, you know, little things that I look at because I'm a streamer, I'm a recorder. You know, I like to do videos. I like to do a whole bunch of things. And by the time buying the Xbox One, getting everything set up, getting all everything to what I'm doing now, and get everything going, I'm still going to spend more money if I just buy a PS4. Even if I just use the capture card that's in there, or even if I buy a new one, an HD one, it's I'm still going to spend less money and then buying, you know, three or four games on top of it. Yeah. I got more of that when we actually get that to that kind of show. But yes, PC is the master race, and it will forever stay that way. But of course, with if you're having some very serious PC voodoo issues like I'm having, consoles looking much better every day. I'm sorry to say that, Yogi, but it's just getting to the point where it's getting hard. I'd rather sit here at my desk like I'm at right now and be playing Xbox at this point, or be playing PlayStation at this point, just because I'm. Yeah. Anyway, moving on.
I love you, but I will not be joining you on the PS4. Unless unless falls off a truck and goes on my curb.
I didn't invite you, though. That's the thing.
Well, screw you, then.
No, we're not. You're not my type. I already told you that, too. We need to have a conversation about sexual harassment in the workplace after this show.
Sexual harassment, panda.
Sexual harassment, panda. The most encouraging thing about the news is that Phil seems to be very authentic. He seems to, I probably, yeah, I said the word. He seems to actually want to make, do the job and actually make Xbox, the division, better for Microsoft. So hopefully he can get that going. But moving, I don't know where I was at, and you kind of did that. So,
sorry.
Every week we try to get into and make sure that we fix mistakes.
So there's still a little part in that. My bad. I was skipping to the part that I was going to read. I thought you were
When Phil was questioned and asked about it, if the E3 announcement would be enough to sell more Xbox One units, he simply responded, "The consumer decides that. I mean, we decide what we want to buy, regardless of what anybody does. You could tell anybody and everybody the Xbox has this, the PlayStation 4 has this. The Xbox has this. They don't have, you can go back and forth all day long. It's whatever your preference is. The last reason why I'm probably going to get a PS4 is because 99% of my friends have PS4s.
Poor saps.
Yeah.
And I bet you most of them converted from the 360 when they said, oh no, Microsoft's going to ban used games being played on the system. And oh, and the PS4 plays in 1080, the Xbox only plays in 720. All that stuff's been blown out of proportion.
It has.
But my favorite thing, though, is that Sony fanboys have always been saying, oh, PlayStation Network is free and you got to pay for Xbox Live. Well, you do too now, so suck it. Though I do gotta say, PlayStation Plus, it's nice that they do offer better free games than games with gold. But I'm encouraged with Phil Spencer. He seems down to earth. You know, he seems very honest and charismatic. I think he's gonna turn things around. But listen to the B team. They got some good news on that, some good perspective. And again, Phil's got a good track record, and he's humble. That's more than you can say about most of these business spokespeople in monkey suits. But, yeah. I'll be on Xbox One soon enough.
Ooh, yeah.
But I still play PC more than anything.
We're always going to play PC. Xbox and PlayStation 4 is just something that we can do extra. Because I'm sorry, guys, and we're on computers all the time. But with what Yogi does outside of the HorsePLAY, he's on a computer 15 hours a day. He doesn't want to be on a computer that much. He wants to play some get on a controller unless he has all that already hooked up to his computer, which he does because he's already showed me before. Wow.
That was rough. I'm sorry. I love you guys in the chat, but I will not ever get a PlayStation. I already had a PS2 and I played it, but I played my GameCube more than I played my PS2. That should tell you something.
Pork Chops is going to leave this. Go ahead. That was a... Pork Chops is going to leave the stream and go, I'm never going back here. I quit my fucking stream on this night to watch this crap.
I have nothing against people that own PS4s. I mean, a lot of my clan members went to PS4. Even though I told them, I'm going to be on Xbox and Xbox 360. and they still went and got PlayStations, and I was like, okay. And they're like, oh, why don't you get a PlayStation, Yogi? Then we can play together. Like, you knew before you bought this system that I had an Xbox, and you still bought the PlayStation. So you don't really want to play with me, and I don't want to really want to play with you. I love you, but sorry.
I want to play with you, Yogi.
Not like that.
Where do you want me to play with? And awkward silence.
Yep. I'm just going to puff my e-cig and pretend that did not happen.
You guys make sure that you guys do listen to B-Team for more of this. And just basically, they're on it like wet and rice. Billy has a great track record, of course, like Yogi said. And we think he could do a pretty good job for the division. Corrections every week, we decide to, you know, we make some. We listen to the podcast, of course, for you guys, and just make corrections that otherwise you guys would point out regardless whether we did this or not. Like, just be official and just say, hey guys, we're going to make a few corrections and give you a couple updates of what's going on in our world with the Geeky Antics gang. And Yogi's going to go a little bit over some of the corrections and updates for this week. Be right back.
Obi was doing the pee-pee dance while he was leaning in like this. You know, just look at his forehead. But, so yeah, a few weeks back, we talked about the upcoming LOL features and, you know, in version 4.x, you know, and some of the stuff in the PBE, the public beta environment. And you guys, if you guys have been following us since day one, we're really big on the League of Legends, but we had to kind of cut our addiction off a little bit. We didn't want to become the League of Legends podcast or a League of Legends podcast, though it is a big part of what we talk about because it's one of the games we keep on a constant rotation. Well, right now we got to get back into it because LOL is heating up and we got to talk about some of the recent updates. One of the things I'm excited about is mystery skins. They're back and they're now 490 RP, 490 riot points, basically like the equivalent of like $5 US roughly. And the cool thing about it is that you can score just about anything. I mean, I think this should always be a thing, the mystery skins, because I've heard of people and some of my friends scoring premium skins like Brolaf and Pulsefire Ezreal for that price. So I might be going in there spinning the wheel because I got some RP stashed away for rainy day. And that's awesome. And I mean, otherwise their pricing is a little ridiculous, but you know, that's the mystery skins is really cool. Another thing, so, you know, with all the April Fool stuff going on, I'm going to make an April Fool's pick. April Fool's, one of the April Fool's that I'm going to highlight is whoever converted Obi from Xbox One to PS4. My heart is hurting right now. But anyway, moving on. Thanks to April Fool's Day, rumors of Riot considering a subscription model started to float around. And, you know, people started really believing this, and they started reporting it on podcasts. We don't ever see this happening as a collective. Me and Obi and I and just everybody that we associate with, just anyone that plays League of Legends enough knows that they don't need to go to a subscription model because they're making tons of money without subscriptions. And we're going to get into just how much money they're making later on in a little bit. But this is not happening. They're not going to subscription model. Free-to-play is what has helped the game grow in just 4 years. I mean, just 2 years ago, with a free-to-play model, LOL surpassed WoW, World of Warcraft, in overall players. And it surpassed Call of Duty in daily logins. And it's still growing. So, I mean, in January 2014, let's put it in perspective, Forbes revealed that League of Legends now boasts an astonishing 27 million daily players and 67 million monthly players, and they report that at any given time up to 7.5 million players are logged on concurrently at the same time. That's what concurrently means, folks. At the same time, 7.5 million people worldwide are playing the game. Now in contrast, when you put that in perspective, let's go ahead and put that into perspective, World of Warcraft had peaked at 12 million monthly players. Just 12 million compared to 65 million. Now, 12 million, no slouch, but still. And that was in 2010, when World of Warcraft hit its peak. Now it's, you know, nowhere near that. Now, estimates place Riot's League revenues at 624 million. Yeah, mind blown, right? Now, for those, moving on, we'll go away from the financials. For those into the professional gaming scene, There's news that talks about how Scara has retired as a player and will be coaching for Dignitas in place of Reggie. Obi, do you keep up with the LCS at all? I could really give two shits. And I only say that because...
Oh, that's a slappable offense.
I'm just saying that because there's people that have all these dreams about becoming pro players, and they're like, I'm going to watch the greats, and I'm going to become just like them. It's like, no, don't do that. Find your own playstyle.
Like every day, man.
I mean, I watch them here and there, but like I love playing League of Legends. Watching it, like when someone else is playing it competitively, those games are very tedious. It's just people farming and waiting each other out, you know? I'd rather have a game with someone, Leroy Jenkins, that does something really stupid like Tower Dive, you know?
I do have some good news, though. I'm not going to tell anybody what pro it is because, yeah, you guys would make fun of them. But yesterday, I did beat a pro in a ranked mid, and it's a pro from an LCS team. Obi, pro?
I'm going to guess that
it's not pro.
I'm going to guess it's someone from Evil Genius, or what's that other group? That whoever they have in the League of Legends...
It's a US. It's an NA team.
Oh, okay.
And I'm not telling you, don't ask.
No, that's fine.
He actually whispered me and added me and said, dude, that was a hell of a game. Nice job. And I was like, it was all luck. All my spears with Nidalee, they just magically land. I don't even know how I hit you. It's like, dude, great job. I'm like,
I love when that happens.
I got my ass stomped. No, whatever.
But all I'm gonna say on that is that there was whoever those douchebags they show on League of Legends when you log in now for the LCS. I forgot what team it was, one of the European teams. It's like, why did they all look like douchebags? They all have punchable faces and they're all like, look at me, I'm a pro player. let me stop. But you know, I'm not much of a following esports, but I do give Scar mad props for poning with Diana. He's kind of brought Diana back in, and she is one of my favorites. Now, Obi, you know, we talked several times about Heimerdinger, and I smell a Heimerdinger nerf coming. Even though we both agree that he falls off late game, I think it's going to happen because they overtune him. His early game is annoying as hell. He's annoying to try to gank. He's annoying to play in mid lane. And now we're seeing him more in top lane because, what was it, the Copenhagen Wolves? Started playing him, one of the players, and he went 5-1. Yeah.
In one. Yeah.
Which makes sense, because think about it, the typical top laners won't be able to counter a Heimerdinger, because he has the range, you know, and he'll outzone them. I mean, then you know, usually you see on top,
Depends on who that top laner is, so.
But usually a top's usually a melee fighter, you know, and there's no one really that can keep up with Heimerdinger in that situation.
Unless you counter, because Jace is actually one of Heimer's counters.
Yeah.
So he's one of his hard counters actually too, because of the melee and ranged attacks. But Heimerdinger, really, all they're gonna do if they do give him a nerf, they might nerf him. Yes, I can't say that. But the only thing I really think they're gonna nerf is his turrets. At low levels between 1 and 5. I think they're just going to lower that damage because, dude, he can put 3 turrets down, and if all those turrets hit you, you're dead.
Yeah, yeah.
He doesn't even have to queue you.
You're forced to stick with your creeps, and you miss out on a lot of farm because of it. You know, you're missing out on those last hits.
Right, well, especially if you play, you know, the melee mids like I do with, you know, Gragas, Kha'Zix, you know, all the other ones that I don't have, that I rarely have, you know, have my Q and, of course, my W on Gragas and Kha'Zix. But really, I want to be able to get in there and actually, you know, use my slam, use my, you know, whatever I'm going to use. You can't do that with him.
Yeah, you can't charge in. But what you call it, they already kind of tweaked him a little bit. Remember, it used to be that he could set down turrets and they would stay active even if he walked away. Now there's like a 1500 range or so with his turrets. He has to be close to them pretty much. So that's fair enough. But I still think he needs a little bit of tweaking. So he's you know, good. He's viable throughout the entire game. But I know now that the Copenhagen played him, you're gonna see a lot of people doing the whole net play thing, trying to copy the build, you know, and do the same kind of kit progression and whatnot. I think it's definitely gonna we're gonna see some tweaking because basically when any of these like MOBAs, RTSs, well not so much RTSs, but like MOBAs and MMOs tend to follow the same kind of process. TCGs too, where when they see the meta is becoming too stale, they start changing things up to encourage different kind of plays. So that's good. But you know, what do you think are some good? I mean, those counters are annoying. Those turrets are annoying as hell. So what are some good counters? I'm thinking Brand, Ziggs, Xerath, or Akali. I'm just throwing Akali. I like Akali.
There's Akali, yes, but you got to remember she is melee, so that's going to hurt her a little bit.
But she's bursty,
anybody
though.
It can do it, but if he hits one turret on you and his stun, he can then turn around one time and hit you with a one-shot and you're dead. Because if he puts a turret, now for Akali, if he puts a turret inside her shroud, you can see Akali.
Oh, yeah.
So it really doesn't, you know what I mean? If Akali hits your shroud and he throws a turret down right there, it's actually going to sit there and you can see her. You could just keep hitting her over and over again.
Yeah.
A couple of good counters for Heimerdinger would be, like I said, Jace, if they were up top. Or even in a mid situation, if you're going to move your mid laner up to the top, but that would be kind of stupid. But you know, little things like that. I think Ziggs would counter him fairly well.
Yeah, definitely for that range.
LeBlanc might counter him fairly well. And that being just because they're range champions, and LeBlanc can distortion in and out so fast that you can, as fast as you can spam your keys.
Yeah,
you know, I play her all the time now, and I love it. Get level 6 and just beat somebody's ass in the ground. But I mean, there's a whole bunch of different ones that you can actually counter him with. But then on top of it, if he gets one, he's like Kassadin. If he gets one kill, he can snowball like a motherfucker.
See, Kassadin, he should not be a ban anymore. I think they should be banning Heimerdinger instead of Kassadin, because he's going to be played a lot more. He's more of an auto pick now.
Kassadin is still a massive threat.
They've reworked him a lot, bro. I don't think he's as viable.
He's still a threat. You got to think, no. Well, the only time Kassadin's really not a threat, and this is getting into playing versus hundreds of them, is if Kassadin can get one kill. Like I was saying with Heimerdinger, this is true for him. If he can get one kill, Kassadin can snowball the rest of the game into a legendary. But it's just that if you can get one kill on him, yes, he can still come back, but he's not going to farm it so safely. He's just going to be, a little bit scared throughout the game. Well, if you can exploit that, then of course.
Yeah. I think Kasterman's like an opportunist. He's an opportunist, much like Katrina, where like if you mess up an initiation, if you initiate the wrong way, or you slip up somehow, you misposition, and then you try to run away. There's no real getting away from him once you let him, hit you to the face. So, but I don't know. I looking at how annoying Heimerdinger, he's just not fun to play against unless you have the right kind of champion against him. Maybe even like a Lux, because you're gonna miss out on a lot of farm because of his turrets. But I would say if people are auto banning Kassadin,
they should consider Heimerdinger one time.
Yeah.
All he has to do is hit the minions one time, and his turret's actually making money.
Yeah.
It's just like Elise. If they're spiderlings, it's just the same thing. Or Teemo kills you with his shrooms. Whatever. It's the same thing.
by the way, Porkchop said GameCube greater than PS2. I agree. I love my GameCube. That was the last time I was really excited about Nintendo. Though I did enjoy my Wii when, for the brief time I had it. But anyway, so let's get to the real meat and potatoes about League of Legends as we know it right now. The team builder, we had talked about that. We forgot to mention URF, which was in private beta for a little while. But those are really the biggest, I would say they're the biggest updates since they implemented the ARAM and mirror matches, right? Now, URF is ultra rapid fire mode, and it's hilarious. Now, if you're the kind of person that's a purist and is like, I only like to play serious battles like Blind Pick or blah, 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 or, you know, ranked queue.
You're missing out.
You're missing, it's so much fun. I mean, you know, all the cooldowns are reduced drastically. 80%. Everyone, yeah, I mean, they go. Obi's been doing his research. But, you know, everyone has unlimited energy, mana, stamina, whatever you're using. And you know, while this mode is meant to be silly fun, I find that it's really a great way to test out the kind of like the effectiveness and sustainability of certain item builds and combos. I mean, you could try characters that you're a little rusty with, different champions that you're maybe a little rusty with, and try new builds out and see how effective they are in clutch situations. Like, I was playing Draven again, and I was playing against some really hard-hitting people, and they were spamming the crap out of me, but the build I set up had so much lifesteal that and attack speed that even though they were doing crazy burst damage, I was surviving all these crazy battles, and I was like in the top four as far as like kill death ratio. I had like only 3 deaths. Everybody else had like 10 deaths or more. It was insane. I definitely had one of the least amount of deaths. So, you know, it's really, I think it's not only just a fun mode, but it lets you kind of like dabble a lot more, experiment a lot more, and just have fun with the game.
Well, and you guys that are kind of like me and you like playing champions that you can spam your Q or your, most of it's your Q, but you can just spam your, because you never run out of mana. So if you play people like I do, like Ziggs, Gragas, LeBlanc, all the guys that have that freaking bursty Q button or the, you know, whatever it is, you can just spam it over and over and over and over and over again. And you never, I mean, you can spam bouncing bombs until you kill him or he goes away. You know, all cooldown reduction is like 85%. So if you look at an alt from Ziggs, which is 100 and some odd seconds or whatever it is, it's only down to like 20% or 32 seconds cooldown for the Mega Inferno. Yeah. But yeah. Anyway, just having that is just, it's just fun. If you guys want to try, go ahead and try it. Get in it. I'm probably going to probably get in it here later after the show. If you guys want to play, we'll rock up some.
I'm down.
A couple people, and we'll take some people from the show that want to play, of course.
Drunken lol. I'm all for it. I'm sorry. I was pumping. I was texting. I'm pimping the show out some more. Texting and tweeting. But yeah, definitely. I'm down for that. I'm actually pretty wired, even though I'm feeling a little nice right now. But, yeah, I'm stoked about that. But the biggest thing that I was looking forward to that's finally here, and I have to dabble with a lot more, is Team Builder. Now, if you're not familiar with this, basically the essence of Team Builder is that you create matches with specific line assignments. So you could switch it up and have a mage top or do a dual lane. And as the host, you get to set up the parameters for the game. You know, Obi's putting his hand up. Okay, hold on, I'll let you chime in. Hold on. But the cool thing is that, you know, the host have the ability to kick people in the mode. And, you know, it's a great, it's, the way I see it is this mode is what we've been waiting for to replace Blind Pick as a testing grounds, as a training grounds of sort. I love this because now we can see some new team compositions, new team comps, and some new lane assignments beyond the usual dreadfully stale 1-1-2 format. You know, it's always one top, one mid, two bot, and that's boring. You break the meta. You know, I think this is groundbreaking, and you know what? Good job, Riot. Good job. I mean, seriously, this team builder thing is great. It takes a little longer to queue up if you have specific kind of requirements, but it's neat because everybody essentially gets to play the role they want. There's no fighting over it, and you jump into a game that matches your playing style and what you want to do. And there's less of this pressure of, oh, you suck at this role, or what are you doing? Because now the people are focusing on their own gameplay, the way it should be, because they're playing the role they want to play. They're playing the character they want to play. And, you know, it's more about them focusing on what they're doing than, oh, you took ADC, I wanted to be ADC, and now you suck as ADC, blah, 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 you lost the game. You know, I think we're going to see a lot less of that because of this team builder. What do you think about it, Obi?
Well, the several, and nobody ever sees me online. That's what I've been hearing lately. That's because I get online at 3 o'clock in the morning or 5 o'clock in the morning when everybody's sleeping. So you guys leave me alone.
And I love it because now I get to hang out with Obi. He's hanging out on my time schedule. That's my sweet spot.
With the certain ones that I've set up each position. I've even went with I think I went Elise and then I picked any. I think I got stuck in the top lane, but it's just. The one thing I like about it the most is you don't have to click that open play or I don't even know. You don't have to, you know, basically when you get into the game, you don't have to get into chat and say mid or top or whatever because you're already choosing. Yep. Nobody's fighting over it. You actually get to, you get queued in with somebody. Like if you have a buddy and I tried it out with one of my friends. Where he went in as support, I went in as ADC. And then, like, 2 seconds later, we picked up a mid laner, a jungle, and a top.
Yep.
Now, it kind of sucks to the point where you have to stick to the meta in there while picking. I mean, you have to have the two bot, you have to have the one mid, jungle, and then top. But, I mean, you can go anywhere. But it's basically they have the same, you know, the other team or whoever you're playing against did the same thing. So you got to remember they're doing what they want to do as well. So the quality of game is going to go up, gameplay. Unless you just queue into a, you know, a bronze 5 player and you're, you know, a gold or even a diamond. Of course you're going to stomp them into the ground. But with the new process that everybody's doing with the team builder, it's actually taking into account what rank you are as well. It's going to put bronze players with bronze players, and then, of course, bronze 1 is going to be into silver 5 and silver 4, and then so on up and on up the spectrum with different levels. So, I mean, I think it's going to be good in that aspect, but, I mean, it's really too early to say anything about it, especially with you know, because like ARAM, when ARAM came out, everybody's like, dude, I don't even like this. This is stupid. Or I hope this stays. Or I can't. You know, I loved it when it came out. I haven't played it in 6 months. Or since it came out. Just because I don't need to. I want to play my 2 or 3 games that I have time for and get off.
Yeah, but you know what, ARAM is sometimes like if you don't have a specific role in mind and you just want to jump into a game real quick and just fuck around, it's a great way to get a quick fix because it usually queues up really fast because people just take whatever they got. Once in a while, you'll get the person that's not happy with who they randomly rolled and they're like, "Ugh," and I don't have any rerolls and then they leave. But for the most part, it's way better than blind pick and no one's going like, "Oh, I wanted to play ADC. Or I wanted to do top." You know, and again, it goes back to that whole thing. You know, people fighting about positions. Now a team builder completely gets rid of that, you know, and
right.
and you don't have the reluctant support anymore because the person playing support is someone that queued in to play support. Done.
Well, and that's the good part about it is, like I say, you just don't have to fight anymore. That's just how it, I mean, that's the fun part about it. It's now to where the point where you're actually getting people that actually want to play the game because they didn't queue into a, they didn't stay in chat fast enough that they wanted mid, and they're forced to play support, or you know, or whatever. Or the ADC is the only thing, and this has happened to me so many times. ADC is the only position left open, and I'm on my Smurf account, and all I have is mages and top laners on that account. Well, it's just things like that. Now I'm glad that we can actually pick. Because then you could just pick, you know, like I pick a lot of times, I'll pick Gragas or Ziggs or Nidalee and just go mid and see what kind of comps, like Yogi says, see what kind of comps you get. There might be a comp that nobody's ever expecting, but then you play it and you're like, holy fuck, this is good, you know. But I think time will tell, basically, with that, Yogi. I really don't want to come across and say that this is going to happen and it's not going to happen and this should happen and, you know, I'm totally being a freaking dumbass for it.
Well, the one thing I'll say,
it can be good if people actually don't exploit and freaking just troll people with it.
It's
gonna happen.
Yeah, I mean, that's inevitable. It is League of Legends, possibly the most caustic community out there. But I think having Team Builder and having ARAM and having URF reduces the toxicity a lot. And if you're new coming into League of Legends, or you've been on the fence about it, or maybe you haven't played in a long time, it might be time to revisit it, because, you know, you have a lot more gameplay options. You can even play Dominion if you want to, though that's probably just as bad as Blind Pick as far as people complaining about how you're playing. But, you know, you have these more casual modes where you can have fun. You can still be competitive, but there's less pressure about, well, I took ADC and someone else wanted it, and now if I suck at it, he's going to freaking flame me every second. You know, if I make one mistake, that's all I'm going to hear. So, you know, people checking your CS, like, oh, look at your creep score. It's terrible. You're terrible at farming. It's like, yeah, but I haven't died at all, and you've died like 20 times. You're still terrible. Kill yourself. You know, it's not always like that on League of Legends, but it is.
You're always going to have trolls, though, man. I mean, for those people that are basically, they play Dota 2 or something like that, and they're thinking about coming over to the League, I can say for a fact, and yes, guys, I'm learning how to play fucking Dota. What do you mean? Your thumb's up. You're the one that's going to teach me. But it's going to be, I really think that if you want something to relax and you want to play a couple games that are actually more people have moved over to, believe it or not, from Dota to League, it's a great game. I mean, I don't have to sit there and we don't have to sit here and plug it the whole show, because it doesn't need to be. League of Legends is League of Legends. I think there's a couple of people in the clan that I'm in, in the armor clan that I'm in, they call it Legion of Leggings. So every time they ask me what I'm playing and if I'm playing that, I tell them I'm playing Legion of Leggings.
Which, fun fact, that matches what was originally going to be one of our, you know, ongoing recurring segments, was going to be League of Leotards. So it kind of matches. What?
You don't want to know.
What? So anyway, we're about an hour or so in. We're a little over an hour, I think, if I'm not mistaken.
Hour and a half.
Oh, wow, already?
It's 12:30, dude.
Wow.
It's been talking.
Well, we're going to try to speed it up, because we have a quickie and a feature discussion we want to have. And I do want to share some of the deals with Cheap Bastards that I found. I don't know if Obi's found anything. But, you know, if you do want to call in and join us for the remainder of the show, as part of our kind of Geeks Engaged pseudo-segment, you know, give us you can call in our voicemail line, 206-415-4987, or add the HorsePLAY account, or just look up HorsePLAY Live, or add geekyantics@gmail.com, and you can add our Skype account, or just connect with me, Yogizilla, and I'll put you in the call. But we're going to be talking about Hearthstone a little bit, and then we're going to jump into our feature discussion about immersion versus reality. So, on to the quickie. So, Season 1 is here, and, you know, Hearthstone's in full effect now, and a lot of things going on. I wanted to share that there is going to be, according to Hearthpwn, there's going to be an iPad media event for Hearthstone. And I believe it's set for April 8th. So as we thought, I'm thinking, pretty soon we're going to be enjoying the game while we're sitting on the can. Because that means the iPad release is right around the corner. Some people are saying PAX East is when it's going to be released. That could be, but it's going to be in April. I have a good feeling it's going to be in April. So stay tuned for that. But Obi and I have been playing a lot of Hearthstone. We've been streaming it. Make sure you check it out on our respective channels, Yogizilla and Obi-1X2. I'm not going to say too much of it, but it was fun. I mean, we played with everything. We played Druid, we played Warrior, Shaman, Obi played Paladin.
If you guys are looking at this, for those that are not watching the live show and they're listening to the podcast, I'm pissed. Okay? I started playing this game long before him. Got into it, got the cards, got everything I needed to do. Well, guess what? We played approximately 10 games in the last 2 days. I've lost 9. I'm not, guys. Yeah, I don't even. I'm sorry. I can't do it. I'm sure Yogi's gonna make a big, maybe a video montage of me losing so many times. And some of the things I said were pretty. I don't want to say disturbing, because they were kind of funny. But if you guys. Guys, wait. Stay tuned for that. Hopefully, Yogi will get it. Get a little video made of our epic times in Hearthstone. And of course, while we're playing, every time we got to make sure we tell him, Yogi, you guys, come on. You guys can join as well. we'll definitely play. We want to get coins, of course, but you know, of course. Again, if you guys do want to join for the rest of the rest of Horseplay, you guys can go ahead and call in now. It is a Skype right there on the screen there. It is Horseplay Live on Skype. You guys go ahead and just add me, and we'll get you right into the call. But other than that, we're just going to talk a little bit about maybe a few voicemails. I think we want to do a few of those. And then we got a quickie, and then we're going to get right into our feature of the evening. Again, guys, if you guys do want to leave us a voicemail, you guys can check out the gang hotline at 206-415-4987. That's 206-415-4987. Hope to hear from you soon. When you guys do leave a message, we will play that, of course, in time pending, of course. If we have time on the show, we'll actually get that voicemail play. Yogi, do you have a few voicemails that you want to, maybe one or two that you want to play?
We got quite a few. How are we doing on time exactly? Because my timer got screwed up for some reason. But we started a little late.
Yeah.
I want to try to keep us a little right out of the two-hour mark.
We're right at one hour and 31 minutes.
Okay. Oof. Man, longer than I thought. All right, yeah, so let's let me get the voicemail going here. Hold on.
Okay. Gonna, well, Yogi's getting... Go ahead.
So I'm going to mute the mic so we don't get the crazy echo.
No problem. Well, while Yogi's getting that pulled up there, we do want to say you guys can connect with Yogizilla and or me to, again, play any games that we are playing currently. And basically, you guys can, we want to play. So anybody and everybody that wants to play, of course, League of Legends is one of our big ones that we play with a lot of the fans and whatnot, but we do have other games. So he is ready for the first call. Here we go. Let's do it.
And I have no idea what's going to happen, so let's go.
It's kind of scary.
Hi, Ovi. Hi, Yogi. It's me, Normie477. I was calling to check in and see how you guys are doing tonight. I hope your show is doing great. As always, it does fantastic. So I'm sure it's going fine. It was relieving to leave me to ask, right? Right. Anyways, I hope you guys are having a great time. Yogi, have you joined any alliances yet on Marble Puzzle Quest? I'm just curious. Talk to you later. Bye.
And, of course, you guys know her by Normie 477. Wait, you want to play another one real quick?
You want to play another one?
Yeah, go ahead. Go ahead. We'll talk about them afterwards.
All right.
What up, all geeks and gamers? This is Obi-Wan X2. It is Tuesday. I don't know the date because I don't have a watch. All right, hey, guys. What's going on? It's Obi-Wan X2 here. And we just want to wish you guys, halfway throughout the week, the best of luck in all your video games and all your stuff. Shout-outs go out to HorsePLAY, of course, hashtag Knuckleballer Radio. You guys check that out. And, of course, guys, remember, we are on Stitcher. We are on iTunes. We are TuneIn Radio. And now, we'll see you guys on Thursday, gang. Peace!
Don't want to talk about it.
Moving on.
HorsePLAY, I have a few questions for you guys, and I would also like to dedicate the song.
I'm going to skip that one because that one is going to be a long one. We'll play that one next week. My friend told me that he sings on this one. It's going to be like 4 minutes long. Let me see the next one.
Derpity derp derp.
Who was that? Do you know? Is that all they said? Derpity derp derp.
Yeah, that's all that was said. There is caller ID on it, but I'm not gonna. I won't sell them out. But the one that's singing, we'll probably play on next week. It's from the same guy that did the robot penis voicemail last week, episode 15.
Got it.
That's gonna be good. He usually calls when he's inebriated, which is fun. But yeah, Norm. But
funny.
But Normie, yeah, she's always showing us love. Definitely appreciate that. And I am on Marvel Puzzle Quest on the Alliance, the B Team Alliance. I'm actually in an alliance with her husband, and he's like super hardcore in the game. I'm good at it, but he's like on a whole other level. Him and Chip are just, they're killing people. They're taking like first place or at least top 5 in every event. It's ridiculous. I get like top 50, top 20 sometimes, maybe top 10, but holy, that game's super competitive. But anyway, I think what we should do before we go into the feature discussion, we'll skip the dust off this time. But I did want to do a quick indie watch, an indie alert, and cheap deals for Cheap Bastard plug. First of all, for indie watch, one of the games I've added to my radar is a JRPG made by Idea Factory and published by Ghostlight Limited. It's called Agarest Generations of War Zero. I'm not familiar with their previous games, but this game looks beautiful. If you like JRPGs and aren't like an elitist when it comes to graphics, the style is really cool. It's anime style graphics. But what really intrigues me about it, besides it being a JRPG, and I personally enjoy those kind of games, you know, Japanese RPG style game, if you're not familiar with JRPG, basically they're usually turn-based game, the more traditional role-playing, like the original Final Fantasy and whatnot. What really intrigues me about it is the core mechanics. You have a card-based skill system, and they have a thing called the Soul Breed system, which allows you to pick a bride and create generations of future warriors, kind of like Rogue's Legacy a little bit. So that customization seems very strong in that game, and very intriguing. So check it out. It's on Steam for pre-order right now, and I think it drops later in April. Agarest Generations of War Zero. And I think if you pre-order it, you get some other games and some, or you unlock some additional content, free DLCs and whatnot. So I might be picking that up. Right now, it's originally $19.99, I believe, but they have it for $14.99 right now if you pre-order it. So that's my pick for the Indie Watch. And as far as deals for Cheap Bastard, I want to make sure everybody's aware that Midweek Madness is going on Steam. And they're featuring the Dead Island series at 75% off, if I'm not mistaken. And they have deals on Forced, which I'm not too familiar with, but looks interesting. Rise of the Triad, the remake, and some other games. And for Free-to-Play Weekend on Steam this weekend, they're doing Monaco, which I happen to own, thanks to Soldierism, our former co-host. And they have it on sale for $3.74. Can't beat it for that price. It is super fun. It's a co-op game, part puzzle, part action kind of thing. Interesting graphic style. It takes a little getting used to, but it's funny as hell. So check out Monaco on Steam, free to play this weekend. And remember, the free to play weekends, as always, they go from Friday through Sunday at 1 p.m. Pacific, 4 p.m. Eastern. That's the definitive cutoff, and it'll be free to play. And then you'll see it pop up on your Steam, and then if you don't buy it by the time that's over, it'll stay on there, but you won't be able to play it anymore, at least not for free. So I think we should do a Retro Friday, hashtag Retro Friday, and play some of these retro-style games, some classics, and maybe play some games together or play games separately and stream them. That's all I wanted to say on that. You ready for the feature discussion, Obi?
Definitely.
All right. So today's feature discussion, I'm going to try to speed it up, because we were hoping Stan Faryna would join us for this discussion. We might have to revisit this so we don't go over time. But we have our discussion here about realism versus immersion. And we have two blog posts you should check out, especially the comments over at geekyantics.wordpress.com, which we will be getting a domain probably by the time the next show goes on. So make sure you are part of our HorsePLAY Steam community to keep up with that and find out new information on that. But on our blog, geekyantics.wordpress.com, we have two articles, one by Obi and one by me, about realism units in FPS games and realism versus immersion. And we also talk about virtual reality and and some game mechanics and whatnot. But, so yeah, let's talk about the face of video games today. You know, the word realism really, I think, means something different to all gamers. So I think we should really just talk about the facets and tangents of realism. One of the first things here, I think the biggest issue with realism is that people immediately think about graphics, right? Is that fair, you think, Obi?
Yeah.
So, you know, there's all this talk about HD graphics and frame rates, and now Ultra HD is becoming more standardized. We're going to see more of that, though we've been seeing that on the PC forever now. It's not a big deal, but As far as consoles go, that's a lot of the talk. But I don't, personally, I don't feel that graphics are necessary for realism or immersion. They can enhance the experience, but it's not so much about the quality of the graphics rather than the graphical assets. And we talk more about that in the article on the Gigantic site. So I won't jump to that too deep into that, but it brings us to the next another point. Can a game be too realistic, right? And what do you think, Jan? What do you think about that? Do you think that a game can be too realistic, as far not just the presentation, but like the actual game mechanics? Is there a point where it's too realistic, where it's no longer fun?
I don't think it's going to be too realistic to where it's not going to be fun. I think it could be too realistic to the age required group. Now, you've seen it as much as I have. Like when World of Warcraft came out, they're like, okay, nobody under 16 is allowed to play this game, blah, 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 blah. But then the first week or so that we had it in, there was 8-year-olds playing.
Oh, yeah.
Putting it out on YouTube. I mean, it was just, they were better than all the 20 to 30-year-olds that were actually playing the game. Now, can the game be too real? I think a realism game, or even an FPS first-person shooter game, yes, it can be too real for the age group. Because really, I know they're going to see it at some point, but does an 8-year-old or a 10-year-old need to see when they shoot somebody, or even just shooting somebody, when they shoot somebody, a whole bunch of blood comes out? Do they really need to see that?
Nope.
And that brings me back to are HD graphics necessary? For me, yes. Because I want to be as real and as immersed as possible. Yes, realism and immersion is totally two different words. The realism part of it is we're what we are. We're a unit in the army, an actual real unit in the army. We're actually we actually do things. We don't use marine weapons. We don't use marine birds or helicopters, airplanes, or anything like that. We are an army. Yes, do I like that part? I love it. Do I like it when I can shoot a sniper rifle and it drops just like in real life? I love it. Will I ever not play this game probably again? Providing if my computer doesn't stop wanting to run it. No. I mean, unless we move to, Arma 3 or something. But I really don't think that it can be too realistic unless you're talking about an age group. Now, the question for you, Yogi. You kind of gave a somewhat of a meaning to the word realism. Now, what is immersion? What is it really to you?
Well, before I get into that, I will say that I think as far as realism and immersion alike, mm-hmm. for me personally, I could suspend my disbelief and become immersed in the video game experience regardless of the graphics, as long as the game mechanics are good. And if it comes to a point where the game mechanics and the fun quotient, as Gabe Zickerman would say, are sacrificed for the HD graphics, then I'd rather have the game mechanics. I'd rather have the fun. To me, realism is about creating believability and having the mechanics that keep you hooked on the experience. So when you talk about immersion, really what you're talking about is being able to escape into a different reality, maybe to the point where you give up the reality as you know it and accept the virtual reality, the digital reality as your own, where during that experience, that might be as real to you or more real than anything that might be happening offline, mm-hmm. And I really believe that's possible. And with all the talk we've been discussing about the Oculus and all the virtual reality stuff we're doing now, PlayStation, Sony's coming out with the Project Morpheus for the PlayStation 4, they're trying to bring back virtual reality again. It might improve realism. It's not necessarily going to improve immersion, Because as we discuss on our site, on the Geeky Antics Network site, the immersion can be disrupted by poor storytelling or poor game mechanics. There's a lot of things that could take you out of that experience or break the fourth wall, where you realize the fourth wall is where you finally realize, oh, if that fourth wall is broken, all of a sudden you realize, you become self-aware, oh, I'm playing a video game and there's no real inherent incentive or value into this experience. I'm just doing it to kill time. That's a bad place to be. When you get into to be fully immersed is to look in that game, play that game, and then be so into it that you just kind of forget about everything else while you're in it. You know, you're enjoying it, you're fully engrossed in it, you're immersed in the experience. And the highest level of immersion, it might be where the point at which you, when you're not playing the game, you're still thinking about it and talking about it with others. And that's how I define immersion. There's a lot of facets to that. You know, customization, personalization, which is an extension of customization. You know, the stickiness of the game. You know, if it keeps you coming back, if you feel like you really need to be committed to it. You know, there's so many different elements that within the scope of this, because we probably can't cover it. But that's the way I define immersion. I mean, what does it mean to you, Obi?
Well, just putting yourself into that reality. When I met my wife, and of course I was playing, for those that know me, I was playing WoW. I mean, a lot. 8 to 12 hours a day. Constantly leveling characters, PvP, raids, everything. And, you know, the one thing that she's, you know, that I still love her for today for it, was she's like, you know, you can play however long you want as long as I get my time, you know, because really when I'm on the game and I'm in a game, I'm not thinking about anything else. I'm not thinking about the fact that my house payment is due or my, you know, my truck payment's due or, you know, anything else. I'm immersing my whole self, my whole mental everything into this game or into this. You're just putting yourself into the game itself and not just sitting at a computer. You're trying to live it. Now, for those that actually get too immersed in it, yeah, I'm going to ask that question here in a second. When they get too immersed in it, now those were the people that you see that, you know, you've seen online to where, yeah, I lost my job because I play WoW too much. Or I lost this because I, you know, that's getting to the point where it's not an immersion, it's an addiction. And we could go over that totally. I mean, we could go over that over and over and over again. And it's basically going to be whose opinion sounds better, really. You were talking about earlier, and it kind of leads us into the next question here, about the 3D, the virtual reality, even with the Oculus, and then some of the different things that you can use for FPSs. Do people really need the 3D and the virtual reality? I mean, that's the first question. I mean, do we really need it?
No, I don't think so. I don't think they might enhance realism, but I don't think there's a guarantee that they enhance immersion. You know, just because you put the blinders on and all you see is the game doesn't mean that you're going to be immersed in the experience, because there's a lot of, you know, game-breaking mechanics and bugs and glitches and other things that could take you out of it.
Right, and that being said, with what you know, you can't really concentrate, you know, how does that impact the experience of using those, the virtual reality or the 3D, you know, the goggles?
I think we're just like in that cycle of time. Like we've seen pretty much every decade, we've seen some kind of virtual reality headset, you know, some kind of mind control aspect. I remember on the NES they had a thing called a U-Force, and then they had a power glove, and then Nintendo came out with the Virtual Boy, and they've had virtual reality headsets that were just really monitors that, you know, put blinders on, and it's gotten way better now. Now the headsets actually have motion sensors that so you can actually control where you're looking with your head, and that's cool. But to me, it's like Kinect and everything else out there, the Wiimotes and all that stuff, you know, the Wii U tablet. It's just, I think that it adds a new way to experience games, but it doesn't necessarily improve the immersion. It creates opportunities for improved immersion and improved reality. Realism, rather. But I think that the problem is that people confuse realism and immersion a lot. A lot of times when we say we want something that's more realistic, you know, what we're saying is that we want something more immersive. But if we had true realism, and I think Fort mentioned this on the comments, if we had true realism in, like, let's say, shooters, you know, FPS games are still very popular. They're probably some of the most played games out there, and there's tons of them. If we had true realism, I think people would not be playing them as much, because it'd be frustrating. You know, one shot, one kill, you get shot in the head, you're dead. None of this walking away from a headshot like you see in Halo and Call of Duty. You know, I remember on Soldier of Fortune 2, it's Double Helix, I used to play on real damage servers. I'm taking it back. That was one of the first games I remember really getting into as far as shooters, and it had an infiltration mode. Hey, that game was dope. It was ahead of its time. It was Call of Duty before Call of Duty was what it is now. And that game was awesome. But it was frustrating. You spent a lot of time just spectating if you died early. But there was no rushing in. You had to work as a team. It had to be very tactical, very deliberate. I was like, all right, we're going to cut across this building here, post up, and then survey the area. We'll send a recon unit out. All right, this unit will go out and try to flank from this direction and create a diversion. You know, we'll create a diversion with this group, and then they will try to flank them and blah, blah, blah. And, you know, we'll use the leapfrog tactic and move forward and push the front line and all this stuff. People get so specific about it. And now we're moving away from it. It's more about arcade-style gameplay, more action-packed, and then no real teamwork and strategy, no real tactics, more like shoot your gun, kill things, good luck. You know, and there's a lot of lone wolf kind of strategy. So I think where we're at with realism, especially in shooters, we're good on that. I don't think it needs to be more realistic. I think it just needs to be more fun and more immersive so that you can't put it down. And then when you do put it down, you're thinking about it, man, that was really fun. Because, you know, a lot of times realism to me is coincides with tedious. Because the game developers work so hard to push realism, but they forget about immersion and the things that make games fun.
True. And there's a couple of things that, and I want to just say this out. So there's a couple of the blog that I put out there. Now the title of the blog was just Realism in Games. How real do shooters or the FPSs need to be or get? Now there is quite a few responses to what I've asked and everything like that. The first one that I want, you know, realism is always a good thing in my mind. However, there are many bad things that can come along with it. One could either go both ways. If you had to pick a side, I would say that with pro realism is his opinion. The bad things and good things that he is suggesting is of course the realism, you know, which is going to be a question here in a second. I'm kind of tie these together for you, Yogi. So it sounds good. But with the realism, I think that he's in his eyes, the pros heavily outweigh the cons. Yes, you're going to have, you know, are they old enough to see, you know, blood and guts splattered everywhere? Because it's not just blood and guts. That shit can get in kids' heads. You know, that's why we have people going up to a high school saying, you know, I don't care anymore, and just freaking, you know, shooting 20 teachers and 30 students. Because they don't care. Because they've seen this on video games that they got to play as kids, or, you know, their parents let them watch the blood, gutty, and, you know, gory movies. I'm not going on parenting advice, because, no. But how kids, what they see and what they hear from the time that they are born to the time that they get the hell out of your house, they're going to remember that. I'm sorry to say it. They're going to remember it some way, shape, or form. Maybe not as little much as when they're young, but yes. Yogi?
Well, I mean, the violence in video games is a whole other discussion, and it definitely is a facet of realism. Mm-hmm. But, and I touched upon that in the article, too. We just got up, you know, just a few hours ago, but not even a few hours, a couple hours ago, really. But, you know, I think what happened with violence is that I don't think the games maybe foster the violent tendencies in the youth or in anyone, really. Mm-hmm. I think it brings out what's already there, but I think all of us, all human beings, have a visceral urge to just kind of like beat up someone, you know, and just seek blood. And in a video game, you could do without feeling guilty, you know, because you're not just gonna walk down the street unless you're some stupid fool and punch someone randomly just because you're having a bad day. But in a game, you could do that, and it's all right. But you know, as far as that goes, I think what happened with developers, they see violence as an easy opportunity because the one thing that everybody can respond to, can relate to some degree. Whereas, you know, something like a TCG, I have a lot of friends that they say, hey, you're having lots of fun with that. I'm hearing lots of good things, but I can't play it because there's no real action. I don't see any monsters fighting each other. It's just a bunch of cards slapping each other, and it doesn't make sense to me. It's like, well, imagine in your head. We'll pretend it's a book. It's like, yeah, but it's a video game. It should have nice animations and epic battles. I don't want to throw cards down and watch them hit each other. You know, and it's understandable. But I think, you know, we complain about violence in video games as parents or just as, you know, conscious gamers. But then we still, you know, we buckle under the pressure and we play them. But, you know, another thing, too, that's worth noting is that immersion is also, it goes hand in hand with stickiness. And stickiness refers to how committed we feel to content. So if something's really sticky, we want to keep coming back to it. But the immersion is more about the experience once you're actually there. And how engrossed you are in it, right? Like a game you could play while you're multitasking probably isn't very immersive. You might really enjoy it. It might be fun, but you're not deeply engrossed in it. You're not getting completely completely disappearing while you're doing it. And then, you know, if you're doing Twitch stream, that's a whole different thing because you have to make a concerted effort to engage with the community. That's a whole different topic. But, you know, a lot of times in games, what you see to make things sticky is they do stupid things like come back every hour so your stamina will replenish, or your vegetables will be ready to be picked, or you'll have another reward waiting for you if you log in once daily, you know, stuff like that. Those are things they do to force stickiness and keep people hooked on the experience. But it needs to be, it all comes back to the core mechanics, and I think that's where game designers are missing the mark. Make the games fun. It's very simple. Make the games fun. And make sure that you have a good balance between challenge and reward. So if you have a high level of realism where it's getting more tedious, there better be a high degree of rewards, a high frequency of rewards. And part of that reward is the community engagement, the community interaction, that social layer where you're enjoying something with your friends. But part of it has to be just in-game stuff, whether you get new loot, new equipment, new upgrades, skins, whatever it is. What happened, Obi? You look perplexed.
You're bugging out a little bit, you're bugging out a little bit. So I'm just going to talk for a second. But it all kind of dials into it with why they make realism games. Because mostly, if you think about it, Yogi, and I know you see what I'm talking about right here. Oops, I didn't do it. But basically, what the question is realism primarily defined, it's primarily defined by visualizations and physical violence. If there's, you know, a lot of explosions, if there's, you know, the physical violence where you can come up and stab somebody in the back of the neck, or, you know, come running down a lane and you're in your speed, you know, set up, and you come down and just knife people as you run by, is that really realism? No, not really, because really how real is it that you can run that fast for that long?
Yeah.
And knife somebody, you know, that's, you know, 10 feet away from you. It's not real at all. Now, when we talk about, you know, realism, you know, I'm talking about, you know, the more of the, you know, the not necessarily the first person shooters, because I've played all the first person shooters, Black Ops, Battlefield, and they're not as real as some of the other realism, and I'm going to say it, but like Arma. Battlefield 4 is to a point, but a lot of the weapons, they don't work like they're supposed to. You know, a tank can shoot, you know, 50 miles and not drop a centimeter. No. Or a tank can't shoot but like 3,000 meters and that's it, when it's supposed to do 10,000. You know, just things like that. If you're looking for those realism games that you can immerse yourself into, here you go, Yogi. I mean, you're going to want to find something that actually has structure into it that somebody else has actually set up or set aside such as a military unit, or even if it's a Magic the Gathering clan. That's all they do is they play Magic the Gathering, and they get together once a month and do a live role play or something like that, or something of that effect. I mean, yes, that is realism too, just on a different spectrum. We can talk about this all night, and I'm not going to, just because Yogi's got something he wants to say, and I know he does.
I do? I don't know. I'm getting some crazy lag, and I want to keep us under 2 hours today so we could get the show prepped to the upload. I mean, we could definitely talk about this forever, but if you want to keep the conversation going, make sure you go to our blog at geekyantics.wordpress.com and check out the articles and comment. Call in via voicemail, 206-415-497. I mean, there's a lot of stuff you could talk about in here, but I think the biggest takeaway I wanted to kind of hone in on was the fact that, people confuse realism and immersion. And on top of that, I think the value of graphics is overstated. Like, people need to stop judging games by frame rate and resolution. It's nice to think about, but I think we're at a point where even if we get those technological improvements soon, it's not gonna improve the game experience unless the other things, the underlying issues, the core mechanics of the games are really done right. And that's what they need to be focusing on. So developers shouldn't be asking themselves, they shouldn't be pursuing realism, they should be pursuing immersion and going back to the roots, making games fun, because when it comes to shooters, I'm very tempted to get back into Arma 2. And I love realistic shooters, but there are some that get so tedious that it's like, all right, let's walk slowly, and then it's like, all right, we can't just jump in because they have far more range, they have artillery, and it's like, whoa, it's a drag. Like, it's cool, but like, I think sometimes you have to draw a line and say, all right, this is a video game, it's going to make some concessions, it's not going to be 100% accurate, because if you do all those things accurately, it won't be fun. It's like Titanfall. In Titanfall, they do these ridiculous things, like a foot soldier is taking out a mech, which sounds stupid, and people could easily jump up onto the mechs and take them over, commandeer them or whatever. And it's like, this was not that mechs are a real thing, but if you try to, put in perspective and think about sci-fi, and there should be some kind of rules in place, it's not very plausible. That's the bigger aspect of realism, is whether something is believable, where you could really just say, all right, I know this is not real, but I could believe it, so that makes it realistic right now. Because people focus on the aspect of realism where it's like, it needs to mimic our world as we know it 100%. And I don't think that's why people are reading books or playing video games or anything. So really, most of us just want an escape from reality. And if that's to a different reality that we could adopt for that brief amount of time or long period of time, whatever it is, that we're enjoying that experience, then cool. It doesn't need to be a complete, copy, a carbon copy of our world.
Right, and I mean, we can go about, like you said, we can go about this all day long. Yes, a foot soldier is not supposed to be able to take over a mech, I'm sorry. It's a machine. One time to where if you do this, and you do this really fast, okay, you're going to do one of two things. You're either going to hurt the person that you hit or hurt yourself. A mech does this really fast, the bitch is dead. I mean, it's just little things like that that, of course, like you said, you can make anything into realism. You can make anything. You can actually submerge yourself into anything. But if you guys did enjoy the conversation so far, and I don't think we're going to be done with this yet, go ahead and join us right there on the geekyantics.wordpress.com and check that out. We do have both, and I'll give you the... Yeah, one is realism units in FPS games, and one is realism versus immersion in video games. So you guys go check that out. Leave a post. We'll read somewhere out next week or whenever we pick this back up. But we do want to make sure that you guys do know that if you did miss Horseplay here, we are on Stitcher, TuneIn Radio, BlackBerry, Windows/Zune, if you guys don't know what that is. That's for the Xbox or Microsoft, and iTunes. You guys can leave us some reviews on iTunes. Would be awesome. We really would appreciate those. And believe it or not, those reviews on iTunes do help us out more than you think. So give us a good, even if it's a little bit of a, what we need to do better, let us know so we can actually make the appropriate changes. We do want to let you guys know you guys can leave us a voicemail at 206-415-4987. Right there above Yogi's head, 206-415-4987. Come check us out. Leave us a voicemail. We'll play a couple. We at least try to play some every episode so we can get those out to you guys as well. And, of course, you guys can email us at thegeekyantics.wordpress.com. Actually, correction, you can email us at geekyantics@gmail.com. I say that like 16 times. And if they're good, we'll read them and play them out loud live on the show. All music was brought to you by TechnoX. That's with a K on YouTube. Go check him out. And, of course, if you guys do get anything from Hondo Bundle Store, anything and everything that goes through the proceeds of the store, they give 10% to charity. We really like that, and we really, you know, we are charity cases ourselves, so we want to support that. Highlight videos and audio casts from HorsePLAY, the uncut versions, the only way to go, are available on this channel right here, Obi-Wan X2, Yogizilla's channel at it's twitch.tv/Yogizilla. And Yogizilla's YouTube channel.
Obi, they're saying they can't hear you on the stream.
Why not?
I don't know. I hear you fine.
Am I muted? Hello? Hello?
Unless you're muted yourself on OBS.
No, I didn't. Hello? Check.
Something funky happened. But anyway, so while Obi's figuring out his situation... where we're at, yeah, so we have highlight videos and audio casts. The audio casts are HorsePLAY Uncut, and the highlight video, the actual videos are HorsePLAY HD, over on my channel, Yogizilla, on YouTube, and on Twitch. Obi also has, highlights on his channel, Obi-Wan X2. And, yeah, some shout outs to our friends, in the podcasting and blogging world, Gaming History 101. Sega Nerds, The Gaming of the Shrew, formerly the Sega Addicts. Casterbur's Doctor Who podcast, and I still have to get out a Doctor Who article soon, so that will be coming to the blog. Stay tuned for that. Origin Lounge Radio, and also Bobby Black Wolf. That's a good show, too. There's a lot of them, but I was trying to mention a few of our friends over different places. R9 Cast, Knuckleballer Radio, Zombie Cast, Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Cast, and the B-Team Podcast, which most of these are at allgames.com. Over at their network and on Stitcher. And also, tons of great blogs that we have been plugging over at the gang site, including some stuff from ZombieCast, Game Theory Podcast, Zombie Blog, Casterbarus, Knuckleballer, B-Team. We've done a little bit of everything. Gaming History 101, we've shared a lot of their stuff. Just spreading the love. And we've seen a huge response from Zombie and Gaming Clan-related content and the talks about realism and immersion. So people seem to really... get game mechanics and want to talk more about the inner workings of video games, so we'll be doing more of that. And you know, in future episodes, you know, now that Walking Dead is over, we'll be focusing, as far as shows go, we'll be talking more about Marvel Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., which has a few episodes left. Arrow, Game of Thrones is coming back, so that's good. And I think that's pretty much it. And Obi, you have sound now.
Yogi's going to be giving out some, or not giving out, but he's going to be watching Doctor Who as well.
Yes.
So, I'm talking about that.
You guys have to wait. Now? Yeah, he doesn't seem to hear you. Unfortunately, with Doctor Who, I have to wait till like the summer or I think fall for it to come back. So that's kind of a drag.
Well, get it? Whatever it is, it's a drag. Whatever we do,
that's just how it is. That's a good positive thought to end on.
Everything we do is a drag. See you next week. No.
Hey, I do.
Guys, we really.
I did want to say one last thing that I think is also worth mentioning as far as realism and immersion goes. The notion of breaking the fourth wall. Check that out in the article. It's a particularly important, poignant, I guess you say, point, because the fourth wall, when developers break that fourth wall through a lot of annoying tropes in video games, it ruins the experience as well. It can ruin realism and immersion alike. And a good example are, besides glitches and bugs, are things like tutorials, where they call out to the player and say, press start. That ruins the experience. And I was like, oh, press X to do this. It's like, ugh. And you got to read that part, because there's a lot of things that's like, you think about it, you may not be aware of it, per se, but when you stop to think about it, it's like, yeah, that does take me out of the experience, because then I realize it's just a stupid game, and I'm like, screw you, man.
I say that all the time, too. I usually get yelled at, no, fuck you! But anyway, guys, we really want to appreciate you guys that have listened and stuck through the rest of the show. This is Obi-Wan X2, along with Yogizilla right here.
Yeah, yeah.
This is Horseplay. We'll see you guys next week.
Peace! Peace.
Holla at your boy. Voicemail. Do it. And one last thing before we go, make sure you guys leave us a voicemail at 206-415-4987. That's 206-495. I'm saying the wrong number.
206-415-4987. And we'll insert a subliminal message into the music.
And we'll put foot in my mouth now.
Delicious.
Thanks for watching, guys. We'll see you guys next week.
Leave us voicemail. Leave us voicemail. 206-415-4987. Do it.
Do it. Do it. Do it.
Paw Patrol. I'll be right back. Body break. All right, cutting off the recording. Peace out, guys.